everyone, and welcome to our panel discussion on how to plan your meaningful travel post-coronavirus. My name is Kayla Patterson, and I am the COO at GoAbroad.com, a comprehensive search engine for meaningful travel programs. And today we're going to be talking about what factors you should be considering for traveling abroad after quarantines and travel restrictions, and why it's important to keep planning your travel right now. So with that said, I'd like to thank all of our panelists for being here today and ask each of you to start off by introducing yourselves and summarizing your role at your organization. So Carrie, would you like to start us off?
Sure, thanks Kayla. My name's Carrie Norris. I'm an international business developer with Clemens Worldwide, which is an international insurance company that's based in Washington, DC, and we specialize in expatriate travel products.
Great. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
And Bill?
Yeah, hi. I'm Bill Bull. I'm the Vice President for Health, Safety, Security, Risk Management at the Council for International Educational Exchanges, CIEE. In my role, my job is to ensure that we have appropriate safety standard support and mechanisms for the 8,000 student travelers we support every year in the study abroad world, and make sure our staff are prepared to respond to any crisis, emergency, or problem. And of course, it's been a busy year.
Yes. Well, thank you for being here with us today. And Kelly?
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Kelly Barton. I'm a university relations coordinator with Barcelona SAE. I am based in New Jersey, and I work with universities throughout the Northeast and across the Midwest. A little bit about Barcelona SAE. So we are a boutique study abroad and internship provider, offering programs throughout the year, as well as customized programs, all in the city of Barcelona. So I'm very excited to be here with you all today and to learn and share a little bit more.
Great. Thank you, Kelly. And Danny?
Hey, how's it going, everyone? My name is Daniel Ponte-Taylor, and I'm Director of Operations and International Partnerships at IOI. And IOI is a boutique NGO operating in Galapagos and in Cuba. And basically, my role is to oversee and improve all the operations in those two locations, including new strategies like the carbon neutral strategy, develop international partnerships with other education institutions, and also oversee all the health and safety operations. So as Bill mentioned, it's been a very busy, interesting last couple of months in that respect. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you for being here with us. And Jonathan.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Gilbin. I'm the co-founder, together with Jonathan Tal, of GoEco. For the past 13 years, we've been recruiting volunteers for programs around the world, in particular, wildlife conservation, environmental conservation, and sustainability. We work with a select few partners, such as Daniel, and we aim to bring volunteers to provide products where they need. And we're here to discuss the future.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you all for joining us. And I'm really looking forward to hearing everyone's perspective on what international and experiential education will look like moving forward, or what we can at least be thinking about in terms of planning those types of travel experiences moving forward. So I think we should start there. From your perspective or the perspective of your organizations, what factors contribute to it being safe to travel again?
Well, one of the things that I think is important is to be prepared. I think when you feel prepared, it gives you a sense of control. It gives you some peace of mind. I think insurance can definitely be part of that. But I think it's really important to have a plan, to discuss some different scenarios and what you would do if something came up, and to make sure that the people you care about that would be watching out for you back home, probably your family, but maybe some of your close friends as well, that you talk it through with them, that they understand what they're going to do, and that you know what your plan of action is going to be, in different scenarios.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point. And I would then ask providers, then we need to add on to that by providing very accurate, factual, and up-to-date information, which I think it will help with being able to be prepared for where they're going. I think that's probably, in my opinion, one of the issues. And the information flow has been so fast and sometimes inaccurate. So it has helped with potentially a bit of fear, with a bit of lack of information or not accurate information. So I think we have a big responsibility to make sure that we provide very accurate, up-to-date, and factual information.
Mm-hmm. I also agree to provide up-to-date information to follow the guidelines of our government. I mean, they will say when we can travel again and when it's possible. And I'm pretty sure they will give guidelines for how to open up an establishment, a program, hotel, whatnot. And I think we have to start preparing to follow those guidelines, which will probably be, you know, in lines of social distancing as much as possible in those locations, and to make risk assessments accordingly, and just to really be prepared for this going forward. And I think it's very possible to do so.
Mm-hmm. Sure, I'll jump in. There's a couple things we've been thinking about here as we talk about the factors for safe travel or safety in traveling. It's much more nuanced than just that. Any sort of safety is considered, you know, it's a function of what are the safety factors and what are the risk factors. And any decision to travel means that you should consider what are the conditions on the ground that lend itself to safety and what are the conditions that increase risk. You know, safety is often defined as the freedom from risk. And I think, honestly, moving forward, that's can't happen. There is going to be risk in travel. There's always been risk in travel. Mm-hmm. What we need to look at, and you might want to look at as a student, is, you know, what are your own personal risks, your own personal health conditions or considerations at play that might get in the way of travel? But start looking and investigating what are the risks on location. Are the hospitals functioning well? Or have they resorted to emergency crisis healthcare management with tents to support sick people, or is the disease being managed within the existing healthcare structure? And then from the safety side of the house, I mean, both worlds collide on some levels of, you know, is there adequate testing? Can you be tested? Can you get care? Can you get treatment? And can you safely come and can you safely go? And all those things combine into an equation that leads to, I can successfully consider traveling provided I take these steps to mitigate, manage, or minimize my exposure and the risk that it impacts me and what risks I bring home to my family when I return. All that has to be factored into any decision to travel.
Mm-hmm. I think I would just add, you know, really on, in addition to everything that everyone has mentioned, really researching the place that you're considering going to, and understanding where they're at in this whole timeline of everything, realizing that not every country is going to bounce back at the same time. Some countries have already, you know, like New Zealand is doing great, but other countries are still, you know, it's still in the midst of it all. And I think really understanding what the local situation is that you're looking at, and like Bill said, make sure that you understand what the risks are of those places, and maybe some destinations may be better if you're itching to go. Some destinations may be more ideal than others, and realizing that these places aren't going anywhere, and that while it may not be safe to go some places in September, maybe the following September, you know, you can go there. So I think being open, being flexible, and really doing your research of what's happening on the ground.
And if I can jump in there too, I think if you're looking at an insurance plan specifically before you go, one of the things to consider would be, does this cover COVID-19 if I get it? And if I do, does the plan offer travel medical evacuation? Does it offer a compassionate visit? Would it pay to fly one of your family members over to stay with you if you couldn't travel home? And also to distinguish between medical evacuation if it's ordered by a physician, or medical evacuation if you choose to self-evacuate. Some policies will cover it and some won't. So read those policies, ask those questions when you're deciding, and decide what kind of coverage is important to you to have. And in addition, you know, with my panelists, researching your destination and finding out what the situation would be there too.
Since we're talking a little about insurance, those are excellent points, Carrie, and by all means, you really should know your policy. You should also look into and consider whether or not you want trip cancellation and trip interruption insurance in addition. But if you're going to do that, does it cover COVID? COVID's part of our world. What if you are diagnosed with COVID 2 weeks before your planned travel? Would that insurance then protect the investment you made into the planned travel if you cannot travel? So it's not merely the what happens if you get it while you're there, you have to know it. But right now, we're talking about mitigating, we're talking about minimizing the impact of this disease, goes into pre-planning, planning while you're there, and post-planning as well.
And then also not only put the responsibility on the insurance, which obviously is very important, but also who you're going with, who you're traveling with, maybe also look into the flexibility plans they may have. I know that, you know, in our case, many others have a more flexible policy for the next 18, 24 months, whatever duration. So you can change dates if things change without really having to ask many questions, but also on flights. I know a lot of airlines have now obviously, they're in a need to obviously open up a lot of business. So they've kind of, they've made their policies a lot more flexible. So ask those stricter questions that normally maybe you wouldn't ask. So don't be afraid to ask a lot of questions about everything. It's a time, you've got a lot of time at home, so it's a time to ask a lot of questions that you're comfortable with, you know, whether it's your insurance, your provider, your flight, from all levels.
Mm-hmm. Also noticed that not many insurance plans cover travel threat level 3 or 4. And you can purchase the full travel cancellation insurance, but I think it's quite pricey, quite expensive, and there's quite a few conditions, and they cover up to a certain percentage. So it is important to read and to see if it's worth the money at all. I'm sure if you got sick with COVID, maybe the insurance would cover, you know, evacuation and so on while you're there. But it's tricky to find the right insurance policy for this time. So it's good to check the cancellation conditions of the flight, of what you're buying, the company, of the insurance, and to double check everything and to see if maybe there's a good offer. Maybe there's a good offer and maybe not get the insurance. And if you're willing to take the chance and just, you know, and maybe not get a refund or get a credit for another year or so on. But it's important to check. It's very tricky out there to find the right constellation, the right way to go forward. But I mean, there are some good insurance policies which I saw, which can cover here and there, but it's not 100% for sure, I think.
And the world's changing, right?
Yeah, world's changing, and who knows if you'll get your money back, or maybe there's, I don't know, it's very complex.
Part of my role is we also have our own insurance company in-house, and that they report up to me, and the reports I get around, you know, the insurance world is running away from trip cancellation policies. Yeah. They're like, no, we're not going to do that anymore. But some are still embracing, you know, trip interruption, trip issues there that are go on the cancel for any reason policies are gone. But there are still ways that you can determine the best policy for you. And if you're traveling with a provider or organization, it's really a good idea to talk directly and specifically with them. They can tell you the types of policies that they've had success with, what they're using, and what their students travel with.
That's right. And I think another important thing to look at is there's a difference between international health, which is considered usually a longer term policy, usually 1 year or more, which if you're an instructor or teacher and you're going overseas and you're going to be there for a year or more, it would cover things maybe like possibly dental or vision or pharmacy, like run-of-the-mill things that you would need. And if you're a student, you may want to consider something more like a travel medical policy. Some travel medical policies will bundle, and so it's not just medical, it's baggage loss or theft of money if you have cash on you, or it may include trip cancellation. So there may be an option for students, if you're looking to bundle, that you could bundle something into a policy that would give you more than one area being covered and that would be suited more to your needs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I think these are all fantastic points and areas of consideration for those that will be planning to travel abroad in the future. You talked a little bit about some of the preparations people should make and who they should be asking questions to. Are there other preparations that we haven't mentioned who are the best sources for information from your perspective, particularly if somebody's thinking about studying abroad or volunteering or doing an internship?
It's funny, we live in a world where there is phenomenal information available to us all. And unfortunately, it's also all information is presented as if it is equal. So we got to be a little careful here and think about as you're going through, what are your sources? Make sure you know your sources. The Centers for Disease Control, they publish solid information. The ECDC, the European Centers for Disease Control, the WHO, all have pretty well-researched, well-documented information that they stand behind describing the current conditions. I think it's important to be aware of is that all these things are talking about how it is now. They're not predictive about what's moving on in the future. They're not saying what it'll be like when you're there moving forward. But look for governmental ones. Look that are follow up on any dubious claims and be careful about information you get from, well, I know some guy who knew some guy who has a family member that lives there and says it's fine. Information doesn't really work that way. It may be fine for that particular person, but it doesn't mean the city is fine or the location is fine. So I would go with the governmental sources that are out there. And the WHO has great maps and great information and great resources and documentation of why it is they say what they say.
And I would add with on that note that obviously going abroad for a meaningful travel, for a volunteer experience, for a study abroad, it's such an emotional decision, so important. So sometimes, you know, you want to find information that fits your, you know, what you're looking for. So you've got to be very objective. You've got to be very kind of, investigative, and just be very kind of, you know, use all your tools, all your learnings you have, and don't just try to, as Bill mentioned, you know, there are so much bias information. Just, you know, you have to do your work, you have to do your research to just kind of get the official information. And even in the official information, there's so much. So try to just sometimes take it a notch down, because, you know, we live in a day where there's so much, sometimes too much, it can be a bit overbearing. So just, try to take the emotions out of it, out of the equation sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Or the best thing to do is, I agree 100%, just follow the advice of the Foreign Office. I mean, right now, I physically can't go anywhere. I can't fly. It's not, so I'm just getting up today, day to day. So I know that I believe the US has a travel free alert for all of the world or so on, and you have to be quarantined for 2 weeks. So we have to follow and see when this will be lifted, and then see what destinations will open up between which destinations, and then just follow the advice of the Foreign Office. I think that's the best, and the CDC and so on. But right now we're kind of restricted, and that's just the way it is. But it may change very quickly. It's like a blank page. We don't know what next month could change, 180 degrees. We just don't know yet.
Mm-hmm. Also, international organizations are very good, obviously, providing that bigger picture. But also ask who you're going to go with, the provider or the institution, because they know the situation on the ground. A lot of times, like, you know, we have direct communication with obviously with high level institutions on the ground, that we get the you know, what's going on, what the plans are, and that's what we use to base our decisions on. So I think sometimes you can plan a little bit more accurately with that information. So combine different levels of information.
I think too, most providers do some sort of pre-departure orientation for students before you go. And I think taking part in that and really listening to the advice from the organization that you are either studying abroad with or volunteering with. As you mentioned, you know, we have people on the ground. Half of our team is right there in Barcelona. They're living and breathing it every day, and they know what the situation is, and they know kind of what the new, we're all kind of learning what the new societal norms are going to be, and kind of understanding that from somebody who's over there, I think is going to be really important no matter where you're going. And especially if you haven't traveled before, and this is going to be your first international trip in a post-COVID world, it's going to look a little different than maybe your friend or your brother or somebody who went abroad last year. So, you know, listening to obviously these government organizations, but also the organization that you're traveling with, who really does have your best interest in mind, and they want you to be successful and have that meaningful experience. So I think don't skip over that orientation. Don't skip over those emails or whatever communications are being sent to you, because they come from a place of, we want you to be, you know, to have the best experience in whatever the world situation is.
There's a one of the group that maybe it was Carrie going to speak, but I want to speak for Carrie on one hand, which is the insurance industry themselves and the travel insurance people have great information and they're a great resource. And they are the ones that may end up paying for whatever happens. So they're going to make sure they've got really good information out there about how to stay safe, what's going on, what the risks are. And when you buy your insurance, they'll give you links to their information sources and go there. Good Lord, I'm a proud recipient of Clements International Insurance back when I finished my Peace Corps experience in Sierra Leone, and they protected me for months as I bounced around Africa. Phenomenal. Great group.
Oh, thanks, Phil. That's great.
Here's your testimonial.
we appreciate that. Yeah, we do work in a lot of high-risk areas, and we look after NGOs, so we're really proud of that.
And that's great. One of the problems, the main problem, is that every country has their own requirements. So when things were changing, when COVID began, and so each country had all these, if you fly through Italy and if you fly through there and you have to go 2 weeks there, and it was so complex. So the best website I saw for that was the World the Association of Travel Agents website. And they put everything in one website. You can look and see every country and see their requirements, because you don't want to go to a country. We have to be quarantined for 2 weeks, for example, in China or something. So you don't want to be stuck for 2 weeks in quarantine. You have to really check it, because it's very complicated. Every country has their own requirements. So you have to check it out, flying for a various country and this again. And that's how it's going to be in the future. So you have to be very careful, I think, in that respect.
Interesting. Today, the best site I've seen for understanding each country's restrictions is run by the UN. It's the World Food Programs map they have that shows you all the requirements for entry and departure, and it even goes into what airlines are flying in and flying out today. So it's, again, information is there. You just want to make sure that you vet it and you're not just going by Bob's uncle said. So.
And I was going to say, another site that is great to look at is the U.S. State Department. I know we mentioned earlier the Foreign Office, and for the American equivalent, that would be the State Department. You can register yourself there, and you can stay in touch with the embassy. They will give you travel alerts from everything to if there's a hurricane coming or if there's a terrorist incident. And now I'm sure with global health situation, that's included. So any kind of thing, that's a great resource to have too.
I can personally attest to that. The STEP program for Americans is quite comprehensive, and they've kept me up to date this entire time on any opportunity for me to evacuate back to the United States. I'm based in the Philippines right now. And yeah, that's been amazing. Not only that, not only the State Department, but also the Department of Tourism in the country that you're in. In fact, the Philippines Department of Tourism has been very active in helping expats and tourists get to where they need to go during this whole situation. Great. Well, thank you all for your input on that. We've talked quite a bit about insurance already, but is there more that viewers should know about what type of travel insurance they should be insuring they're having? I know, Carrie, you mentioned like ensuring that it would cover any possible scenarios as a result of COVID. But let's pretend that we're in a period of time when maybe that's not the largest concern anymore. What is the general policy that someone would want to have participating in a program abroad?
I think, you know, one of the things that we would have thought about and that we still do think about in the pre-COVID-19 world, which was really only just a few months ago, was to look at, you know, what other high-risk scenarios would it cover? You know, would you be studying in a relatively high-risk place like where Bill in Sierra Leone, or would you be studying in a different place? Like, you know, in the past, I studied abroad in Spain when I was in college. It was a wonderful, life-changing experience. And I really want other people to have that experience too, whatever program they choose, because mine was so wonderful. We wouldn't have thought of Spain as a high-risk country now, but with COVID now, all of a sudden, all those things are changing really fast. I think different high-risk scenarios. Is there a war and terrorism clause? What if there's, you know, somebody has a thing where they would, you know, do an act in a country where we wouldn't think that that would happen? That's a concern now. So I think to really research what you think could be the risks that you're facing in your individual country. You know, what if you're on a study abroad in South America and you are doing biology and you want to go diving? You know, certain hobbies, skydiving or skin diving, could be considered high risk activities, and you may want to make sure that there's a clause or an endorsement that would include those kinds of activities so that you can have the full kind of experience that you want and you just feel covered. Another thing that I would think about is if you're an instructor, maybe you would want, and you know, you may want to consider having a life insurance policy or a disability insurance policy that would cover you if you couldn't work or if something that happened. But if you were a student, I would look for maybe something that would bundle, or I would see what the new options would be for a travel policy that may include trip cancellation and a medical situation and maybe some kind of property situation too, like if your laptop gets lost or stolen, or if your cell phone has something happen to it, because you want to make sure that you can stay in touch with people. That's important.
Sure.
Yeah. And you're the expert in insurance. I'm not going to add too much on insurance, but based on my personal experience, having managed programs for over 15 years, one of the things that I would also say is like a lot of insurance are country-based insurance, so kind of like insurance for X country. Nowadays, obviously, you fly via many different hubs. So also kind of, you know, research where you're going to fly and where that your hub destination, your hub is also covered. Mm-hmm. Because of your, you know, especially now with COVID, maybe like even you add insurance in COVID and in some you fly via X location that then you didn't know that then you're going to have to be quarantined. So that adds up to the insurance as well. But I found it very interesting. You mentioned diving, skydiving. You know, we have diving as part of our programs. A lot of times people don't think those are high risk activities, but also ask, you know, because we've had instances where the insurance did cover diving, but the medical situation on the ground, that maybe there was no chamber. So, okay, so diving was covered, but the minimum standards for the insurance were not met. So again, be very kind of read the small print of the insurance, but also ask then your provider or who you're going to go with if that's going to be okay, because sometimes there's a disconnect between those two.
That's right, Daniel. And you know, you want to ask and you want to find out if those things are there. And you may be able to add it as an endorsement. Don't assume that something's covered. Ask them, because they may be able to do something. And another good point I think that you made was, if you're traveling through multiple destinations, you want to find out, like, you don't have to wait until you get into the country to get an in-country insurance policy. You can look at a good expat program before you leave that will cover you from the minute you leave your house while you're in transit, going around to different places and in your destination. So you can get something that will cover you across multiple countries and while you're in transit as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You started the question is, what do you recommend for your specific policies? And you'll notice no one ever answers that question directly, because there are too many factors that go into play. And one of the things you want to think about too is, it's a good idea if you're traveling, is talk to your doctor as well about your own medical conditions and therefore what types of insurances you want to have. Mm-hmm. And then talk to the insurance about what conditions you may have that might be considered pre-existing and not covered, mm-hmm. and some that will be covered. And it's all about, you know, managing your expectations and preparation. We started this earlier, we skipped over it, but it's really clear, is prepare for what's available, what isn't, make a backup plan for when it doesn't work. That's how anyone manages travel. But insurance-wise, your insurance should fit your needs. And you should always have as much insurance as you can possibly swing, because if you need it, you want it.
Sure, absolutely. And I know we're getting towards the end of our conversation here, but I want to throw in or add on another question, just to make sure that we're not completely focused on all of the unanswered questions and uncertainty right now about international travel. But why is it important? I want to hear at least from a couple of you about why it's important for students and potential participants and travelers to be continuing to look at and apply for future programs. I think a lot of people right now are thinking, why should I even pay attention to that, because there I can't go anywhere. But I think we've been working really hard to talk to potential travelers about why it's so important to continue that planning process. And also, there's a lot of good deals they can get right now, too.
I think that travel means empathy. It helps you understand a different perspective that's not your own. And having that experience up close and personal, and being able to rely on the decency of strangers in other countries that eventually become friends, or being able to have the experience of mastering a foreign language and carrying that forward and being able to connect to someone who doesn't speak English because you've had the chance to go out and learn another language or experiencing something different. I think that builds really strong leaders for the world. I think we desperately need that. We needed it before COVID-19. We need it during COVID-19. We're going to need it after. It's propelled probably everyone on this panel in some form into an international career. I know Bill had studied abroad. I did. I think, you know, we're all cheering for those programs and wanting them to succeed because it's helped each of us in our own international careers. And I know I personally want to see people go out and experience the world and have the peace of mind to do it and to take that step and to be adventurous, because it's such a tremendous experience that can lead you into a wonderful place in the future.
Yeah, I mean, I think all of us here have been touched by international travel. We've seen so many amazing examples, real case studies, not just theoretical case studies of people being changed completely. And, you know, we live in a world where, you know, maybe things will change, but like we are, you know, we interconnect it. So that global understanding, global cultural understanding is very important. And, you know, there's so much that we're going to learn from this COVID-19, how we can improve things virtually. But I think there's nothing going to take away the face-to-face, the smells, the hearing, the learning from a different culture. And I think hopefully we will kind of have a more combined virtual real, and that will help kind of environmentally probably, but at the same time nothing's going to replace it. And I wanted to just briefly, because we focus so much on COVID, and we were talking about, you know, what this, you know, COVID, post-COVID-19, I think one of the things that I've seen is that this has sort of helped pause everyone a little bit, and also pause the world and nature. And we've seen some amazing things happening in the environmental world. So I would say when people start researching post-COVID-19, of course, look at your insurance, look at the health and safety, look at the you know, how the country's reacted, but also look at, you know, what your experience is going to be doing from a sustainability perspective. You know, people think sustainability is only related to environmental programs or projects or courses. Sustainability it's in all shapes and forms. So kind of ask the questions to your providers, to your universities, you know, how is my experience going to contribute to global sustainability, cultural, environmental, economic sustainability? Because that's really where we're going to start making a change. So let's take the pause that COVID-19 has made us have to make international travel, and in this case, education travel, more sustainable moving forward.
I absolutely agree with Daniel. Such an important point, sustainability. And going forward, I don't know what's happening with flying. Maybe it will be more difficult, more expensive, more complicated. I'm not sure, but definitely if we travel less, stay longer, consider carbon offsetting, consider car programs, that is much more sustainable than flying for a weekend and coming back. We do consider that type of travel, and I think it's much more sustainable. And I think we could definitely accommodate this in so many ways, because we're in this field where people come for long term. They fly and stay long term with us, and I think that's very sustainable in the terms of flying and CO2 emissions in that respect. And also, I wanted to add that I think it's important to plan off on two levels. One, I think the NGO world is collapsing right now. I think when we plan now a volunteer program or something like that abroad, we support now these organizations, which I think is important. And second of all, I think in the traveling world, there are many great offers to take advantage of. So I'm sure everyone's going to offer some great packages, great offers. It's good to check. And it's good to buy now, and it could be like a gift card for the future. Buy now, buy a great deal now, and in the future you can use it, and at the same time support the local organizations around the world. I think it's a very good time to plan travel, even for 2021. It's a very good time to purchase traveling and to think sustainably, of course. This is very important.
I think what's really interesting with this pandemic is obviously it's worldwide. On this call right now, we have people all over the globe. So in a way, it's kind of something that we've all endured in one way or another. And so what's really interesting with that is it, you know, can't really associate this crisis with one city or one country in particular, because it has been so wide reaching. And what's been kind of really amazing to watch is how people have continued sharing their culture virtually and connecting with others online and continuing to kind of create those moments as best they can, even when we can't travel. And so I think once this all kind of clears up and restrictions are lifted and we're able to move again, I look forward to talking with students again and kind of encouraging them to explore and go to these places, because it isn't just one place that's been hit. It's been so wide reaching. I mean, I live an hour from New York City, and New York City has been hit incredibly badly. And, you know, it's right in our backyard. And so I think don't restrict it to, oh, this place was bad or that place was bad. You've got to look at the future and look at, you know, like, we've all had amazing international experiences and we all hope to continue having these. And I think just moving forward, looking at how it's been something that, you know, we can reflect on, but also still enjoy and explore the world. The world's waiting for us. We just have to give it a little more time and then we can get back out there.
Mm-hmm. Time to plan for future travel is before the future's here. So now would be the time to think about a future that you want to exist in and be in. And I think what Jin's and you were all saying, variants of the same thing, is we also now have an opportunity now to consider not just traveling, but sustainable and ethical traveling. Mm-hmm. And in a COVID world, ethical traveling means, you know, going, choosing locations where you're not going to be a strain on the local healthcare system. Mm-hmm. Sustainable travel means the things that, you know, Daniel and John, they were talking about, that you're improving the world as opposed to just merely going and viewing it. You want to go participate in it. That kind of travel changes you as a human, which is something we've all learned gives phenomenal value and makes the world a better place.
Mm-hmm. Couldn't agree more. I think you've all given a lot of great examples about why we should keep dreaming, is what we keep saying to our users. Keep dreaming, keep planning your travel, but be educated and know what information and questions you need to ask. I think this has been a great discussion, and I hope it'll be very useful for our viewers. Before we wrap up, I do want to give you guys a chance to add in any last quote unquote pro tips or tidbits or takeaways. What if there is one thing that you could tell someone who was planning a program, what would it be? What should be their main takeaway from this?
I think being flexible and being adaptable and realizing that what your idea of study abroad or volunteering abroad or interning abroad, what you think it may look like, it may look a little different for a little while, but that doesn't mean it's any less meaningful or impactful. If anything, it might be more meaningful or impactful because these are different times. So I think just being adaptable to what your perceptions are. I mean, I think that's something with travel in general. You have these expectations and then you arrive and it's completely different, but it's often so much better than what you've kind of predicted in your mind. So yeah, going into it with an open mind, but being ready for things to be a little different as they are in your everyday life. So, yeah.
I think it's important to plan ahead for peace of mind, whether that's, you know, taking that extra foreign language class or, you know, making sure that you figure out your international insurance before you go. Have a plan that will allow you to reduce your anxiety. It will allow you to focus on the experience. And I think it'll set you up to have a lot of success on your program and a great time.
Yeah, don't be afraid of asking as many questions as you want. It will help you prepare and ask the tricky questions that sometimes people don't want to ask, and you don't want to receive. But in my case, I want to receive those tricky questions because it means that someone's done their research. They want to actually make the highest impact when they get on the ground. And I would also add one that in organizations, NGOs like us that work in sustainability, kind of like ask, you know, how have they reacted to this COVID-19 on the ground? Have they been supportive of the communities where they've been kind of working for many years, or they just said, sorry, we don't have any money, we have to leave? Because I think that really brings, you know, Bill's point about ethical traveling, but in this case, ethical programming and ethical kind of long-term planning. A program can't be focused just around the student, the volunteer. It needs to have a long-term impact, a long-term strategy. And, you know, COVID is going to put a couple spanners on the work for sure, but it should have this long-term strategy. So ask those questions, you know, be critical in the good sense of the word before you make a decision.
I got stupidly practical with my thoughts on this one. Maybe it's because I'm a dad and I've got a kid that's a senior in college and a freshman in college. But here, three things. Pay with a credit card that has purchase protection programs on it. Reserve a window seat because the mitigation is perhaps less exposure. And then disposable socks. So when you transit through airports and those sorts of things, they make you take your shoes off. Again, the goal is COVID's here. I mean, I know we say post-COVID a lot, and I say it, but we're not post-COVID. We're still COVID.
Yeah.
So plan for that. You know, plan for packed masks. Plan for masks to be lost if packed in luggage. Put them in your carry-on. Hand sanitizers. We know the things we can do because they work. Australia moved to a requirement that everyone is required to wear a mask, and they saw a 90% reduction in new infections. We know how to do this.
I agree. And I think, you know, practical advice is good. And I think, you know, you can plan now your trip, look at, you know, different offers, find a good, worthwhile, meaningful program, like Daniel said, see if there's a special offer, and be flexible and see what their conditions are. Maybe if you can't go, there's a condition where you can get a credit for next year, and be flexible about that. So, okay, so I'll go in 2021 and so on. Be flexible and see if you can get a unique offer for a very good program. And I agree, bring extra socks and so on to the flight. And I think, again, I like to say, like, you know, I don't know how flying will be, but think not flying too much. Maybe fly once a year, go on one program. It's much more sustainable. You're not going to fly 10 times a year. Maybe think of something worthwhile to do, you know, once, twice a year, not fly, you know, so much. And I think that's a very good way forward. I think flying may be hassling in the future. There may be requirements and, you know, measures, and could be expensive and it could be complicated. So focus on something. I think one thing which is interesting.
Absolutely. Great. Well, I think those are all fantastic tips. And if there's anything I can add, I think it's just to make sure that you rely on these providers and these professionals who are doing so much amazing work right now, collating all of the valuable and important information and making sure that they're designing safe and great experiences for you in the future. And now, online and virtual programs. So there's a lot of different options, and there's no reason to turn away from your meaningful travel dreams. So to our viewers, thank you so much for tuning into this panel discussion. We really hope that this is useful for you. And if you have any questions, please add them in the YouTube comments below and we will answer them. And please take a look at GoAbroad.com to browse program opportunities abroad, as well as online from all of these providers and many more. Thank you all so much again for joining us.
Thank you. See you soon.